the most crowded river parade ever. Hundreds of thousands of people. Their chant at the mayor and the city hall float was, build them an arena, build them an arena.
You always want to go to the voters when things are swell.
It was a community that came together and said, you know, we can do this.
We wanted a world-class basketball arena.
We were not asking for anything different than what was occurring throughout the NBA.
It's one of those places like you enjoy as a competitor going into that environment because you know it's going to be hostile.
When you came to a Spurs game, you had a great time.
We wanted to create something for everyone.
I'm George Strait. Texans love stories, and I've got a good one for you. It's about a community of people who came together and built a place they could call their own, a place where they could go and be entertained, and where everyone was welcome. This is the story of San Antonio and the SBC Center.
We knew when we moved into the Dome that it wasn't likely a long-term fit. It was built for football, and it had amenities and offerings and sight lines that were great for football, but didn't deliver the basketball experience that we wanted.
And the Alamo Dome was a good interim step, but it wasn't the long-term. And to be able to have a basketball arena to watch basketball, the game just totally changed.
Remembering their time in Hemisphere Arena and being right on top of the game and how loud it was and how exciting it was. And, you know, that they realized was kind of lost in the vast volume of the Alamo Dome.
The Alamo Dome, as good as it was, we had too many seats.
We needed an environment where fans would participate with us 44 games out of the year.
Well, none of this would have happened without Peter Holt and his willingness to take some chances.
If you look around the league, there's a ton of arenas built between, you know, 96, 97, and 2003. And the majority of those have some sort of public funding. And the team, the organization, the ownership group, was having a terrible time having any progress there with the city or county or state or anybody.
You'd watch other cities and other communities lose their sports teams. This was something that was happening all around the country, and we didn't want it to happen here.
And so McDermott's plan was to bring in new ownership to inject capital, energy, leadership into the organization. And so that's how my mom and dad were brought into the picture. And it wasn't until we won the championship and we had the River Parade and literally the vote happened that fall. So 2 months later, 3 months later, and they voted yes.
That we got together this morning, from our point of view at the Spurs, we think this is the first time we've really been able to make our proposal to all the taxing entities in one room. We've said all along, the reason we need a new arena is to be economically viable and stay competitive in the smallest market in the NBA. And so right now, our proposal is as we've stated.
Peter came to us and asked if the Greater Chamber would endorse the building of the new arena, which of course we did unanimously.
All of the business community were concerned, and their message to me is we want the Chamber to do whatever is necessary to keep that team here. If part of that is building an AT&T Center, let's build one.
So there was a lot of starts and stops in looking for a new home for the Spurs.
And there was a couple of locations at the time.
The city really was focused only on downtown. That's where they wanted it to be. And prices were expensive downtown. It was hard to get enough land downtown.
They were interested in the same arrangement that we previously had at the Alamo Dome and at Hemisphere Arena, where we were a tenant in a building, but not totally run the building, not have the building available so that we can have other events, concerts, family shows, not be able to sell all the suites, to sell the naming rights, all of the revenues that streams that come with a modern day arena. Cindy was involved to the point of getting a mediator involved.
to try to help the city understand that this was the economics of the NBA at the time.
Cindy Taylor Cryer really had a vision for how it could take this community to the next level.
It really didn't have anything to do with basketball. The rodeo needed a new facility too. We thought, can we put these two groups together in a way that it makes sense for the whole community?
And the more we talked about that, the more it seemed like a very viable option for us.
We were there to help the community find a way to keep the Spurs in San Antonio and to provide a facility that would help with lots of other events. We would be creating a facility that the rodeo could use in order to have more seats, to sell tickets, make more money off of the tickets and sponsorships that they sold, and most importantly, use those funds for scholarships to send students from all across Texas to college. And seeing the importance of that went beyond the Spurs, beyond the other events that we were talking about, and just created a vision of how much we could use this building in our community.
The county really had a vision that was directly in alignment with what we knew would be next for us as a home, and partnering with the rodeo was just the icing on the cake.
So we ended up with a campaign that was called the Saddles and Spurs campaign.
And now all over the world, they got San Antonio on their lips right now, baby. Everybody's talking about San Antonio.
The mayor and city council had a float, so I, you know, by position got to ride on a float. And as our float would come around the corners and remind you, hundreds of thousands of people along the San Antonio River, the most crowded river parade ever, hundreds of thousands of people, their chant at the mayor and the city hall afloat was, build them an arena, build them an arena. And it was fantastic. And as a elected official, the will of the public was incredibly clear.
You always want to go to the voters when things are swell.
I've never seen a community this big come together all over town in so many ways to support their home team.
But let's admit it, number one was David Robinson, Tim Duncan, and Sean Elliott, and Avery Johnson. I mean, those starters of that 99 team. I mean, you know, that's what really got it done. But, you know, you did have to get the vote out. And I believe the volunteer base of the rodeo was instrumental in getting the vote passed.
I'd like to extend the congratulations of the NBA to the ownership of the Spurs, to this spectacular city of San Antonio, and to your 1999 NBA champion San Antonio Spurs.
But there was nothing more magical and more aligning of stars than ring night, opening night of the 99-2000 season, when we raised a banner into the rafters for the first time, being aligned with a community vote that eventually approved the funding for the AT&T Center. And thinking about how the community celebrated in so many ways that championship and the future that it built for not just a team or the rodeo with a new home, but this community with really the next step in building a major league franchise in San Antonio and in our community.
That was the best campaign victory celebration ever, because it was in one of the stock barns right out here. And it really, again, brought the whole community together for the Spurs, for the stock show and rodeo, for all the other events we could have there. And it was a big victory. It wasn't one that was nail-biting at 10 o'clock. The votes had been counted. It had won overwhelming support, and it was going to be built.
Incredible to be able to have a place that's state-of-the-art, where you're just like the big boys as far as facilities are concerned.
Having spent years at the Dome really helped us to identify objectives of what a next home might look like. And some of those were important to building the fan environment that was necessary, not only to deliver the experience our fan was looking for, but also to deliver home court advantage, making it difficult for visiting teams to come in because the environment was just that electric and that motivating for our own team to deliver a franchise that could match up with the larger markets.
To be there when that building opened and was just, you know, it was a dream.
We have all waited a long time for this day, and now it has finally arrived. Yes, the inaugural game at the SBC Center in San Antonio.
It's, you know, it's crossing the finish line. It's what you work for and train for if you're an athlete, to cross that finish line. And our whole team, everybody, put a lot of work into it, and we all crossed together. Give credit to SBC at that time, which became AT&T. They really understood the magnitude of what this building meant to the city.
People don't understand, like, the fans in San Antonio are so prideful. They're so in tune, and their IQ for the game is so high, like, they're into every moment. It's one of those places, like, you enjoy as a competitor going into that environment because you know it's going to be hostile.
The San Antonio Spurs are NBA world champions. Let the fiesta begin. The San Antonio Spurs have won their third NBA World Championship.
San Antonio is back on top once again. The Spurs are the 2014 NBA champions.
All of the collaboration and partnership that had to happen in order for the AT&T Center to be built, it took everybody to accomplish that.
Everybody had a stake and tried to make this franchise state of the art. And although we weren't blessed with a lot of the resources other markets did, when you came to a Spurs game, you had a great time.